Recording. Okay. And you can share screen. Screen. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Good.
Okay.
Okay, so welcome back to the lecture. He's gonna tell us about, vertex operator today.
Yes, so today I want to explain vertex operators. So I'm going to construct a certain set of vertex operators for any semi-simple Frobenius manifold and study some of their basic properties. First I want to start in the most general settings when you have just a symplectic vector space. So more precisely, let me remind you, this is the symplectic vector space that I want to start with. So you have any finite dimensional vector space equipped with a non-degenerate symmetric bilinear pairing. And then we put a symplectic structure on the, so this is the symplectic structure on the space of formal Lorentz series with coefficients in H. So I will work for now with this vector space, with this symplectic vector space. I want to explain, so the first topic would be vertex operators and quantized symplectic transformations. So I will define vertex operators and I want to explain how to conjugate them with quantized symplectic transformations. So let H be the symplectic vector space. The one that I just show you, then given any vector in H, we can define a linear function on H by taking the symplectic pairing, by pairing with the vector F using the symplectic pairing. So this is a linear function. And then we can quantize it using the quantization rules. So I define the quantization of F to be H of F quantized. I want to write it even more explicitly. So this is just some linear differential operator, first order. So explicitly, so let us write F in the form sum n over all z I n minus z to the n, just any element in the symplectic vector space. I want to use this occasion actually to introduce this notation. I'll denote with f plus the truncation of this sum, so this would be sum over only positive powers of z. And similarly, F minus would be sum over only negative powers of Z. Okay. Let us write A, a point in our symplectic vector space. I use the book coordinates that I introduced last time. Okay, maybe I will denote this index with A. So then you have QKA VAZ to the K plus PKA VA minus Z to the minus K minus 1. And then you can compute that H of F which equals omega of F of A is equal to sum k from 0 to infinity, and then you have well, there is a sum also over A, and then you have we have I minus k minus 1 paired with phi A qk A plus then you have then we have minus 1 to the k plus 1, it is ik phi upper A pka. And so this is the linear function. And then the quantization hf is going to produce the full, the just the first order differential operator. Okay, and now these linear Hamiltonians and their quantizations, they actually span a Heisenberg Lie algebra. So more precisely, we have the following proposition. So part A, so the Poisson bracket of HF and HG is omega of FG. And the commutator of F quantized G quantized is also omega of F G. Right. So this is exactly what it means, that linear and constant functions will give you a Heisenberg Lie algebra. And then, the last property. Well, this is actually very important. So if A from H to H is an infinitesimal symplectic transformation, then we have the following identities. So first of all, the commutator of the quantization of A and F, right? By definition, this is the quantization of HA. HA is a quadratic Hamiltonian. HF is linear Hamiltonian. This is the same as you take the Poisson bracket of HA and HF, and then you quantize. And this is actually turns out, this Poisson bracket turns out to be the same as the linear Hamiltonian corresponding to AF. So in other words, this is AF quantized. And so we have this nice formula that infinitesimal symplectic transformation, when you quantize them, they commute in a nice way with the quantized linear Hamiltonians. And this proposition, the proof is straightforward, so I leave it as an exercise. And then the vertex operator is just an element of the Heisenberg group. So if you take any element in H, then the expression e to the f minus quantized and e to the f plus quantized. In details, this could be written as exponential of sum k from 0 to infinity, sum a from 1 to n. Then it is I minus k minus 1. Actually, I wrote it on this side, okay, paired with phi A an exponential This is called a vertex operator. Then the next goal is I want to explain how to conjugate how to conjugate with lower triangular symplectic transformation. So conjugation by lower triangular symplectic transformations. In other words, by lower triangular symplectic transformation, I just mean an operator series of this type, just like the calibration. So here SK belongs to endomorphisms of H, and this satisfies the symplectic condition. SZ, S of minus Z transpose is equal to 1, the identity. And now, in order to, so this conjugation produces some phase factor, which is defined in terms of the following quadratic form. So let us define first endomorphisms WKL endomorphisms of H. So here K and L are non-negative integers. So it's defined by the following identity. Sum KL equals from 0 to infinity WKL Z to the minus K W to the minus L equals S of Z transpose times S of W minus 1 divided by Z to the minus 1 plus W to the minus 1. Note that the right hand side, thanks to the symplectic condition, if you put Z equals minus W, the numerator becomes zero, which means that the numerator is divisible by denominator. So therefore, you will get a power series in Z inverse and W inverse. So this definition makes sense. So using this WKL, then we define a quadratic form on H plus. Namely, if you have two vectors in H plus, so let me write it as sum K from 0 to infinity and G equals sum GL Z to DL, then we define W of F G to be sum KL from 0 to infinity, then you take FK WKL GL. Okay, one can check that this is actually a symmetric form. Let me give you some proposition that give some properties of this construction. So part A, we have WKL. So WKL is some quadratic expression in the S matrix. And more explicit, it could be given explicitly by this formula. SL plus I. Okay. Part B, WKL transpose is equal to WLK. Again, here the transpose is with respect to the pairing. With respect to the pairing. And this condition implies that W of FG equals W of GF. So the form, the quadratic form is symmetric. And finally, there is also a simple formula for the quadratic form in terms of the symplectic pairing. Namely, you can check that W of FG is equal to omega S of F plus, and then S of G minus. So you apply the symplectic transformation to both F and G. In the first case, you keep only the positive powers of Z, the non-negative powers of Z. In the second, only the negative powers. And this is straightforward to prove. So it's I don't discuss the proof. And now using this proposition, let me show you how we conjugate the vertex operators. Okay, so suppose that we want to compute S hat e to the F minus hat e to the F plus hat S hat inverse. Let me explain a consequence of this formula, namely of part C in proposition one. Note that by proposition one, part C, we have the following relation: e to the A, e to the minus A, right? This is equal e to the at of A hat F hat, right? Which is sum k from 0 to infinity, 1 over k factorial at A hat to the k of F hat. But now commutator with A acts as multiplication by A, right? Thanks to this proposition. So therefore we can rewrite this as sum k equals from 0 to infinity, and then this would become A to the kf quantized divided by k factorial. So therefore this becomes e to the A F quantized, right? So therefore we can easily conjugate each of these terms. So from this we get that S hat e to the F minus hat e to the F plus hat S hat inverse is equal to right, so I write it as e to the F minus hat and now this becomes e to the S of F minus hat and this becomes e to the S of F plus and then quantized. But now, you see, when you quantize vectors that have negative powers of Z, they have multiplication operator. They correspond to multiplication operators. And when you quantize vectors with positive powers of Z, they become an annihilation operator, so differentiations. So the first term, so this term here contains only negative powers of Z. So it's okay, but the second one is mixed because S is a power series in 1 over Z. So this has both negative and positive powers. So therefore, let us split this this term. So let me write this term as e to the SF plus, I take the negative part of this, and then S of F plus the positive part. And now this, so let us transform this. So I keep the first term as it is. And now for this term, I want to use the Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula. I want to write it as a product of two exponentials because the commutator of these two things is going to be some scalar, so it will commute with all of them. So in this case, this BCH formula is very simple, and namely it will give you exactly the following expression, e to the minus 1/2. Well, the commutator of these two things is exactly the symplectic pairing. Plus. Right, and then I can write e to the S of F plus minus times e to the S of F plus. This commutator here, so let me look into this term. So maybe I can write it. So first of all, know that we can forget the positive sign here in this formula, because if you include negative terms, if I allow negative terms, then when I apply the S operator, I will get negative per term, and they will be truncated when I take the positive term. So therefore, I can ignore the positive sign here. And then I could rewrite this as e to the 1/2 omega of S F plus, and this is S of F plus minus. Actually, in this case, I think I don't need to take the plus. Maybe I can just keep the plus here. It's better to keep it, actually. And now if you recall this proposition for the quadratic form, right, proposition to part C, this symplectic pairing is exactly this quadratic form, right? So therefore, this actually equals e to the 1/2 W of F plus F plus. Okay, so therefore my formula will take the form e to the 1/2 W of F plus F plus. And then this would be e to the S F minus plus S F plus minus quantized, and this would be, so now in this formula here I'll forget the positive sign, So I'll write it as e to the s of f plus quantized. And now this expression here is equal to s of f minus, right? Because you can write f as f plus f minus, and s of f minus minus is the same as s of f minus, right? Because s f minus has only negative powers. Or if you wish, you can write this as minus, right? So anyways, at the end we get the following formula: e to the 1/2 w of f plus e to the s of f minus conjugate e to the s of f plus conjugate. So let me write it now. So let me write this derivation. So we proved that s hat e to the f minus is equal to e to the 1/2 w of f plus, then we have e to the s of f minus plus. So this is the formula. This is how we conjugate with lower triangular transformation. So we'll need this formula in order to conjugate with the calibration. Now, some similar exercise should be done for the upper triangular symplectic transformations. So let me just state the result. So conjugation by upper triangular symplectic transformations in other words, these are symplectic transformations of this type: r of z equals 1 plus r1z plus r2z square plus and etc. Here rk are endomorphisms of H, and we have the symplectic condition. And just like in the, so the discussion is parallel to the previous case. So let us define VKL endomorphisms of H by the following identity: sum KL from 0 to infinity VKL z to the K W to the L equals 1 minus R of Z R transpose of W divided by Z plus W. And out of this VKL we define a quadratic form on H minus is defined by in this way. So if f equals sum k from 0 to infinity f minus 1 minus k z to the minus 1 minus k, and g equals sum l from 0 to infinity g minus 1 minus l z to the minus 1 minus l, then we define v of f g to be sum k l from 0 to infinity, and then it's minus 1 to the k plus l f minus 1 minus k v k l g to the minus 1 minus l. And we have the following proposition. I think it's number three. We have VKL equals it's such an explicit formula for VKL in terms of the R matrix. Part B, the same thing is true. This is a symmetric form. So VKL transpose is equal to VLK, i.e. this form is symmetric. And the last part is that, again, there is a formula for the quadratic form in terms of the symplectic pairing. Okay, and this time I'm not going to give you the argument, but we have with a similar argument yields the following conjugation formula. So you can prove that R hat inverse e to the f minus. So if I conjugate the vertex operator by R inverse, by the conjugation of R inverse, then you get exactly e to the 1/2 v of f minus, and then e to the R inverse f minus quantized plus quantized. Right, so this is so that's how we quantized with these upper triangular symplectic transformations. Okay, and now I want to switch back to the settings of semi-simple Frobenius manifolds. So maybe if someone has a question or wants to see the notation again, now is the time to ask.
I have okay. One question.
Yes.
If you go outside a semi-simple world, what's going to happen? What goes wrong? Or like a...
I think that so if you go to semi-simple, if you don't have semi-simplicity,
yep.
I think that so for example, I'm going to define this vertex operator. They also make sense at non-semi-simple points. I think that this is something that I think nobody explored actually. You see, I gave you a formula for the total descent for the total ancestor potential. Maybe I try to find the formula. I guess it was here. Right, so this is the formula. So you see, if this is semi-simple, then we have this decomposition for this total ancestor potential. Actually, if you look in Gromov-Witten theory, a definition of the total ancestor potential makes sense also at non-semi-simple points. So somehow, both this R matrix and this delta I's, somehow R has a at non-semi-simple points, R would have a pole, but this would have zero. Delta. So somehow they cancel in some miraculous way. So this limit, I think that for many Frobenius manifolds, this limit will exist also at the non-semi-simple points. Mm-hmm. And actually, we are going to study a non-semi-simple point as well. So somehow the total descendant potential corresponds to the most non-semi-simple point in some sense.
I see.
Yeah, so these constructions that I'll explain, they do not... semi-simplicity is used only in order to reduce the vertex operators that I'm going to use to vertex operators of the KdV hierarchy. This is the only place where I use semi-simplicity. But maybe another place that that I use semi-simplicity is well, when you look at the Laplace transform of the structure connection, it's a function connection. So if your Frobenius manifold is not semi-simple, I'm not sure that you have this property. I actually didn't study the case, and so that might be a problem in the non-semi-simple case too.
I see. Okay, thank you very much.
Yes. Okay, so then let me continue to the next topic. So vertex operators and semi-simple Frobenius manifolds. Now I want to apply the construction that I explained just to in the settings of Frobenius manifold. So suppose that we have a semi-simple Frobenius manifold, right? So this is the Frobenius multiplication, Frobenius pairing, unit and Euler vector field. So suppose that this is a semi-simple Frobenius manifold. Again, I'm going to fix a point, a semi-simple point. And I'll denote with T1 up to Tn flat coordinates in a neighborhood of this point. And with U1 up to Un canonical coordinates. And we apply the quantization formalism to the vector space H equals the tangent space at M. Or as I said in my previous lecture, you can think of H as the space of flat vector fields in a neighborhood of T circle. And this is identified with the cotangent space using the Frobenius pairing. And now we have a natural choice of dual basis here, namely you take phi a to be ddta and phi upper a to be differential of ta. So I want to assume also, suppose that M has a calibration. It's calibrated. So in other words, we have a symplectic transformation. Etc. So Sk of T is an endomorphism of H. There exists a nilpotent operator such that the following conditions are satisfied. So first we have the symplectic condition. Uh, second, the commutator of the grading operator with rho is minus rho. And the last condition is that y of tz equals s of tz, z to the theta, z to the minus rho, is a solution to del. And now I want to define the coefficients of the vertex operators. So put I tilde m a of lambda to be the following vector valued function. So it's e to the minus rho d lambda dm lambda to the theta minus m minus 1/2 divided by gamma of theta minus m plus 1/2 applied to a. So here m could be any complex number and a belongs to h. So now if you look, this is a very simple explicit formula. So theta is a diagonal, it's a diagonalizable operator. Rho is a nilpotent operator, so therefore when you exponentiate here, you have finitely many terms. And when you differentiate with respect to m, you're going to get some logarithms of lambda. So therefore, this is some kind of a polynomial expressions in logarithm of lambda and possibly some fractional powers of lambda. Right? So it's very explicit, simple formula. Let me draw a picture how I'm going to think of this as a function. So I want to explain where. Let me define actually the real the coefficients of the vertex operator. So they're defined in the following way. So we define I m a of t lambda to be sum k equals from 0 to infinity minus 1 to the k sk of t I tilde m plus k a of lambda. And now the picture is, but before I draw the picture, know that here when you increase k, you're basically, so if I start increasing m, so if I add m plus k, right, so here this series k goes to plus infinity, right, then it means that as I increase m, I'm increasing the negative powers of lambda. So therefore, this expression makes sense at least as a formal Lorentz series in lambda, near lambda equals infinity. Right? So a priori, it's it belongs to C of lambda inverse. I should write fractional powers of lambda, but let me abuse the notation just to write this. Right. Let me draw the picture. So the picture is the following. So this is my Frobenius manifold M. Here is this point T0. And somewhere here, I choose another point, lambda circle. So this would be the point with coordinates T circle, lambda circle. This would be my reference point. So the vertical direction is just C. So this is a picture of M times C. Also somewhere here, let me draw a picture of this line, this complex line. Namely, this is a picture of T0 times C. And now there is an important hypersurface here in M times C, which is called discriminant. So it could have several branches. So this is called discriminant. So the discriminant is by definition is the hypersurface to M times C, such that the determinant of lambda minus E multiplication by E is zero. In other words, for each, if you fix a point T, then the points on the discriminant above T, they correspond exactly to the eigenvalues of this operator. But if you remember, if you write in canonical coordinates, this multiplication by E is a diagonal matrix with eigenvalues, the canonical coordinates. So therefore, these points here are exactly of the form T times a canonical coordinate. At least if T was a semi-simple point, then, so in a neighborhood of a generic semi-simple point, our discriminant looks like n branches, each one corresponding to a canonical coordinate. And here we choose this lambda circle to be so big that all canonical coordinates are inside in some disk, right? So you put all the canonical coordinates, let's call this UI circle. This is the origin zero. This is the real axis, and somewhere here along the circle is a positive real number, a lot bigger than, sufficiently big, right? And now we can use the principal branch of the logarithm to define these functions, I tilde m a of lambda. Therefore, our definition of our period so far, so the definition of these periods, maybe I can use some green color. They are defined so far in a neighborhood, in some neighborhood of this point, T0, lambda 0. So in this definition, I am assuming that T is sufficiently close to T0 and lambda is sufficiently close to lambda 0. Okay. And now, so this is actually what, so the next proposition is what would allow us to extend this definition globally. So we have the following proposition. The series of T lambda is a solution to the following system of ODEs. Lambda minus E multiplication by E d lambda I m of T lambda equals theta minus m minus 1/2 I m of T lambda. Well, I guess I can put A here. And then d dt k of I m A t lambda is equal to minus phi a, and here it's d lambda of I m a of t lambda. This is for all k between 1 and capital N. So this is this proposition is straightforward to prove. It simply follows from the differential equations for the S matrix. And in fact, this system of equations, it's in some sense, it's a Laplace transform of the differential equations corresponding to the structure connection. So sometimes it's called second structure connection. Second structure connection. And now let me list several remarks. So first of all, we can view the first equation as an isomonodromic. So this is an isomonodromic system. Dromic system of function differential equations. And in particular, since in lambda, the differential equation in lambda has only regular singularities, it follows that this series IM A of T lambda, which a priori are only formal Lorentz series in lambda, they must be convergent. This is a property of a regular singular point. So IM of A T lambda is a convergent Lorentz series. Near lambda equals infinity. So in particular, this implies that my definition, which is given by this infinite series, is going to produce an analytic function in this green domain. And now using the differential equation, both in the lambda and the t direction, I can actually extend the definition of this t lambda to any point that you choose, maybe somewhere here. Then in order to define the period, you have to choose a reference path that goes around the discriminant. And then we can uniquely extend analytically along this path. And actually we can even say that this is a Lorentz series is convergent, and actually it is convergent in, I can be even more specific, is a convergent Lorentz series for absolute value of lambda greater than the maximal absolute value of a canonical coordinate. Well, eigenvalue of the Euler vector field. Right? Because you can see from the first equation that the only singularities are the eigenvalues of the Euler vector field. So therefore, your domain of convergence of the Lorentz series is at least as big as this. So it's convergent for this, and IM of A T lambda extends analytically along any path avoiding the discriminant. Discriminant. Second remark is that we have a monodromy representation. This is just the monodromy representation of this function differential equation. So let me denote it with R. So this is a homomorphism from the fundamental group of the complement of the discriminant with base point T circle on the circle to endomorphisms of H. Right? So here to a closed loop C, to the homotopy class of a closed loop C, we associate a linear operator RC. By the following definition, so the analytic continuation of IMA of T lambda along C equals IM RC of A T lambda. Okay, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about this monodromy representation later on. But now the next remark is that you can easily check from the definition that dd lambda of im a of t lambda is equal to im plus 1 a of t lambda. And another important relation is that the derivative in the unit direction is equal to minus dd lambda. And in particular, this implies that our periods have the following symmetry. Zero. So they depend on this difference t minus lambda 1. So t minus lambda 1 is just t1 minus lambda 1, t2, etc. tn. So this is the unit direction. So somehow this lambda direction is in some sense redundant for these periods because of this symmetry. But nevertheless, it's more convenient to think of these functions as functions on m times c than just the functions on m. And then I want to make one more remark, which I think I didn't write. I wrote it in my note. So maybe the definition looks very ad hoc, but the way that I came up with this definition is just from the examples in singularity theory. So in singularity theory, these periods IM, so IM with M less than zero, to be more specific. So if you run this construction in singularity theory, then this IM coincides with the differential of the period map corresponding to QG situs primitive form. So that's why sometimes I refer to these multivalued functions as periods. We call IM A of T lambda periods. Okay. These periods are going to be the coefficients of our vertex operator. So, put FA of t lambda z to be sum m in z I m a of t lambda minus z to dm. Also, let me denote f tilde a. Actually, f tilde does not belong on t. Right. Z to dm. And then know that by definition, and then we define the vertex operators, gamma alpha of t lambda is just you quantize f alpha. This is the vertex operators corresponding to f alpha of t lambda. So it's f alpha, you take the negative powers of z and you quantize, and then it would be f alpha plus, and you quantize, and similarly gamma tilde alpha of lambda is e to the f tilde alpha minus z. Again, there is no dependence on t here. And now, by definition, we have the following correlation. F alpha of t lambda z is exactly S of t z applied to F tilde alpha of lambda z. So therefore, if you recall our conjugation formula, then we see that if you conjugate gamma tilde alpha of lambda with S in inverse, the quantization of S inverse, then we get this. Divided by 2, and then it's gamma alpha of t lambda. So these operators, gamma tilde alpha of lambda, they're explicitly given, right? So they are given by some explicit functions. And gamma alpha of t lambda, these are vertex operators that are very complicated because their coefficients are these period vectors. Right, and the two vertex operators are conjugated by the symplectic transformation, by the calibration is. Now I want to introduce the notion of a reflection vector. At this point, maybe it's instructive to give an example. Suppose that M is just the one-dimensional Frobenius manifold. If you use, this is the quantum cohomology of the point. Right? So here the multiplication is just the usual multiplication of complex numbers. And the pairing is just the identity, this one. The Euler vector field is t dt. T is the standard coordinate on C. E is equal to d dt, the unit vector field is this. And in this case, the canonical coordinate coincides with the flat coordinate. Also the operators, both operators theta and rho are zero. And now if you look into the definition that I gave, then you'll find that this period, the corresponding period Im of u lambda is equal to 1 divided by square root of pi. This square root of pi comes from gamma of 1/2 d lambda to dm lambda minus u to the minus 1/2, where for negative m, we define, so d lambda inverse of lambda to d alpha should be understood as lambda to d alpha plus 1 divided by alpha plus 1. So just integration, right? For negative m, this means that I integrate the corresponding function. Right, and you can compute these derivatives or antiderivatives explicitly in terms of m and find some explicit formulas. Right, but the reason I give this example is because now for any Frobenius manifold, let me denote also with f point of u lambda z the following series: sum n in z minus z d lambda to dn 2 divided by square root of 2 lambda minus u. So compared to the formula here, I rescaled this by some constant, by square root of 2 pi, basically. And this is some normalization that will become clear later on. And now for any so now suppose that so I want to make a definition in which we should think of the following settings. So again, suppose that this is my Frobenius manifold, right? So this is my reference point, this is the discriminant. I want to think of a point which is sufficiently close to the discriminant. So suppose lambda is sufficiently close to ui. And then I define the following series. So now I'm going to use the other quantization operator, the upper triangular symplectic transformation. So before I defined the periods using the calibration and then I was working in a neighborhood when lambda is a neighborhood of infinity. Now I do something similar, but I'm in a neighborhood of the discriminant. So this symplectic transformation is applied to the vector EI times this series that comes from the theory of the point UI. Maybe I emphasize the dependence on T lambda Z. So I make this definition. So here EI is the normalized idempotent, right? So here EI EJ is delta IJ. So this is an orthonormal basis for the Frobenius pairing. Okay. And then one can prove the following proposition. So the proposition is that this series that I just defined solves the same differential equations as before. So if you write, so if you expand this series Fi t lambda z into the powers of z, you get something like m in z I am I of t lambda minus z to dm. So this series here is an element of lambda minus u to the minus m minus 1/2 h lambda minus ui. So a priori it's a formal, should be viewed as a formal power series in lambda minus ui, formal Lorentz series in neighborhood of lambda equals ui. And the worst possible pole, it has a pole of order m plus 1/2 if m is positive. So and then these coefficients is a solution to the same system of ordinary differential equations as the period vectors. This is the statement. In other words, this, where was the system? I think it was here. So it's so I claim that this series that I defined in a neighborhood of the discriminant, they solve the same system of differential equations. And in particular, again, lambda equals ui is a function singularity for our connection. So this must be actually convergent Lorentz series in lambda equals ui. Okay. So, and the conclusion from this is the following, that if you fix, so now if I fix some reference paths, maybe from, so let us fix a reference path, just any path. Avoiding a discriminant. Discriminant from T0 lambda 0 to T lambda. Then there exists alpha in H such that this solution, that this Fi of T lambda Z equals F alpha of T lambda Z, right? So since both ways solve the same differential system of differential equations, then this solution Fi must be obtained from the first method by analytic continuation, right? So, and such an alpha is called a reflection vector. And next time I am going to explain, it will become clear why is it a reflection vector. Reflection vector. You know, maybe if you want to have here, maybe it's a good thing to make analogy with the hypergeometric equation. So you see these periods that I defined, there's some kind of standard solution near lambda equals infinity. So I solve some function differential equation, and near lambda equals infinity there's some Frobenius method. So you write some formal Lorentz series in lambda, you substitute them in the differential equation, and you find recursively the coefficients, right? And if you do this, then you obtain the definition of the periods. And in this second approach, I took another singular point, namely lambda equals one of the eigenvalues of the Euler vector field, and I do the same. And then you can ask for the following problem. How are the two solutions related? And for the hypergeometric equation, there are some connection formulas that answer this question. And here the point of these reflection vectors is to address this problem. So how are the standard solution that you construct near lambda equals ui related to the standard solutions that you construct near infinity? And if you want to know the answer to this question, you need to determine the reflection vectors of the Frobenius manifold. So this set is what is be important for me. So the set of all alpha in H that are reflection vectors. And then again, now if alpha is a reflection vector, then there is a nice, the vertex operator gamma alpha of t lambda, if you conjugate it with this symplectic transformation, it's going to give you e to the 1/2 v of f alpha minus inverse. And here you'll have some vertex operator, which is again given very, it's very explicit, right? So this vertex operator gamma point of ui lambda is just the quantization of this series. And this vertex operator gamma point ui lambda, this is exactly the vertex operator that is used to define Hirota bilinear equations for the KdV hierarchy. And it acts exactly on the ith copy of the Witten-Kuntsevich function, right? So let me make just a remark that in singularity theory, this set R coincides with the set of vanishing cycles. Coincides, but somehow you have to since this is a tangent space to our Frobenius manifold, to be precise, I should say that you have to take the period map of QG Psi 2 defined by the primitive form, and then the image of this of the vanishing cycle by the primitive form by the period map will give you the reflection vectors.
Here, okay, so here, sorry, I have a question. So this R is a set of reflection vector. It has nothing to do
with the R matrix, right? The R matrix. Okay, so okay, maybe okay. Let me write curly R. Okay, thank you. This is a good point. So maybe I could use curly R to denote the set of reflection vectors. Okay, great. Right. It's just a set of... yeah, some in the interesting example, this R is some it's some discrete set which usually it's difficult to find explicitly. But from my point of view, it's very important set, right? It gives you this kind of connection formulas for the second structure connection. It tells you how the solution defined at infinity are related to the solutions defined in a neighborhood of the discriminant. I still have 10 minutes, so I want to discuss a little bit these phase factors that appeared. So here there are two important formulas that I wrote. One of them is this one here. Right. And the other one is when I conjugate it with the calibration S. Maybe I put it this one. And in both cases, there are some phase factors. This is what I call phase factor, just exponential of this quadratic form. right? Here it's, this W was defined in terms of phase. And here you have this phase factor defined in terms of the R matrix. And in both cases, there is a nice way actually to write these expressions as integrals over certain one form on the Frobenius manifold. So this is what I want to discuss now. And I'll do this for one of the phase factors, and for the other one, I'll continue tomorrow. So so let me write the phase factor. The phase factor W of F alpha plus. I can put F tilde, actually it was tilde, right? So F tilde alpha plus F tilde alpha plus. So by definition, this phase factor is the following thing. It is sum KL from 0 to infinity. Then you have minus 1 to the K plus L. Then WKL of T. I tilde L alpha of lambda, and then I tilde K alpha of lambda, this pairing, where the coefficients WKL of T, so these are linear operators that are defined by this identity. So now the calibration is satisfies a differential equation with respect to t, right? It satisfies which comes from the structure connection. So in other words, the Dirac differential, the Dirac differential on the manifold M of S of Tz is equal 1 over z a. A of t applied to S of tz, where this A of t, this is the connection matrix in the Dobrovian's connection, is just sum A from 1 to n. Then here you have Frobenius multiplication by phi A dt A, right? And now if I let us differentiate this identity, apply the Dirac differential, the differential with respect to t in this identity. Know that on the right hand side, the numerator will get exactly this kind of expression, 1 over z plus 1 over w a of t. It will exactly here in the middle, such expression will be inserted. So 1 over z plus 1 over w will cancel the denominator. So therefore, we get the following formula. Differential of wkl of t is equal to s transpose k of t a sl of t. And now if I differentiate the phase factor with respect to, if I take the Dirac differential of the phase factor, then we'll get this is 1, 2. Okay, so we will get exactly, right, so I have to substitute this formula here. Right, so this formula, I have to substitute it here. And then we get, this is equal to sum KL from 0 to infinity minus 1 to the K plus L A is L of T I tilde L alpha of lambda, and then SK of T I tilde K alpha of lambda. And now the summation over L would give you exactly the period IL alpha of T lambda, right? And actually the summation over L will give you the period I zero alpha of T lambda. So therefore this becomes A I zero alpha of T lambda. And the other one would give you, the other summation over K would give you exactly I zero alpha of T lambda, the same thing. And now this equals sum A from one to N. So now the connection form is just this. You take the Frobenius multiplication dTa. And now I can use the Frobenius property to rewrite this as phi A paired with I0 alpha of T lambda, Frobenius multiplication I0 alpha of T lambda dTa. And actually I'm going to denote this form even just like this, I0 alpha of T lambda product I0 alpha of T lambda. So in principle, these periods, they take values in H, which is actually was the tangent space at the point T circle, our reference point. But now if you use the Levice-Vita connection, you can identify this also with the tangent space at T. So therefore, we should think of this I zero alpha T lambda as of the periods could be taught as vector fields, multi-valued vector fields on M, right, via this identification. I guess for me, this is the definition, right? This is the definition, and this identification is with the Levice-Vita connection. And then this becomes, this product here is exactly the multiplication at the point T. So via this identification, this is naturally interpreted as a vector, as a tangent vector, and using the Frobenius pairing as a covector, right? Using the Frobenius pairing. So therefore, via this identification, I can think of this expression here as a one form. And this is the one form that I had in mind. Okay, and so therefore, this proves that our phase factor could be written as an integral of this one form. And tomorrow I'm going to continue and I will show that the other phase factor also can be written as integral of this one form. So somehow this the study of this one form becomes the key to understanding these phase factors. And that's what I want to do tomorrow. I think that I'll stop here today.
Okay, thank you very much. Any question from audience? So you construct the tau function by using vertex operator.
I still the tau function. Which tau function?
For instance, Kontsevich. So we can Kontsevich tau function.
No, I well, I
this gamma point.
I'm using. I'm just taking. I'm using just by definition, the Witten-Kuntzevich-Tau function is just some specific generating series, and mm-hmm. I'm going to use Witten's conjecture proved by Kuntzevich that it's a tau function of KdV.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I see.
So in some sense, I don't construct it with using vertex operators, but mm-hmm. I'm going to use the tau function satisfy some Hirota bilinear equations.
Mm-hmm. I see.
That are they will be defined exactly in terms of these vertex operators, gamma point.
Uh huh.
So I'm going to use the Hirota equation that the tau function. That the Witten-Kuntzevich tau function mm-hmm. satisfies Hirota bilinear equations defined in terms of these operators.
I see.
And now by conjugating with this given tau SAR matrix, uh-huh. These vertex operators are transformed to vertex operators corresponding to reflection vectors.
Uh-huh.
And now the goal is to construct Hirota quadratic equations for the total ancestral potential using these vertex operators, right?
Mm-hmm.
And this somehow, I don't know how to do it in general. Only in some examples, I know how this works.
Uh huh. I see. And this second structure connection. This period satisfied.
Yeah, this one. Yes.
Yeah. So is it? How does it have to do with connection of that appear in Frobenius structure?
So the relation is the following. Uh-huh. So let me write it. So if. Is a solution to mm-hmm. second structure connection. This integral, mm-hmm. I could denote it with JTZ equals, there's some normalization factor which I think should be minus M minus 1. Minus 1/2 here, and then you integrate e to the lambda over z. I am lambda, d lambda, and now the cycle. This is the subtle part that you have to make. You have to choose a cycle such that the integral makes sense and integration by parts works.
Mm-hmm.
If you can do this, then this Laplace transform of I am of the period will give you a solution of the structure connection.
I see. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
So in this sense, this is the second structure connection is a Laplace transform from the structure connection.
I see. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Okay. But here, right hand side depends on M. So
yes.
J left hand side also should depend on M. Somehow.
No, it does not, because you see, if I multiply, suppose that I increase M by 1.
Mm-hmm.
So right, I could write it as minus 2 pi z to the minus M minus 1/2 integral along gamma e to the lambda over z
mm-hmm.
minus mm-hmm. the minus 1. Mm-hmm. And then I plus 1 a of t lambda d lambda. Right, so I claim that these two integrals are equal.
Okay.
And now this could be taught as minus d lambda of e to the lambda.
Oh, I see.
I just got this form.
seems like you're busy on taking care of a kid, so maybe it's better to postpone the question to
No, it's okay. Very simple answer. So this is equal to this, and then if you're using okay, so I want to say that if you use integration by parts, so this property of the period would shows that it's independent of the choice of m, right? Because you write integral e to the lambda over z, and then becomes d lambda of phi. But probably here I should write minus m probably instead of m. So, so probably I have to write. So probably with my formula here, I'm not quite sure. I have to check. It's minus m probably.
I understand. So because
you increase m by one, then it becomes minus m minus one.
Yeah.
And then it's okay. Then this would become minus m. Yeah, I think it's the negative period, because actually the negative ones, at least if you choose this a to be a reflection vector, and you choose a to be a reflection vector here, and the cycle gamma should approach the corresponding canonical coordinate. And then the negative periods, they vanish at this point. So therefore the integral is convergent. If you take positive m, they have a pole at lambda equals ui, so the integral is divergent. So therefore, I think indeed the formula here, you have to take m to be negative.
Okay.
Or I mean, you should put my. We have to put here minus m, not m.
I see. Any other question from audience? Chris, looks like Chris is clear so far. So, but your today's talk somehow looks to me very general for isomonodromic problem. Looks to me. Does it really rely on this Frobenius structure and so on? Like, it's, if you have symplectic vector space and
yes, in some sense, if you use just some isomonodromic family of a function connections, you can still define this. You can try to define these periods. I don't know whether you get some meaningful theory, whether you can construct still some vertex operators and define representations of vertex algebras. I didn't try to do it.
Quite possible, looks to me, yeah. And it looks very interesting problem.
So, I mean, the theory of isomonodromic deformations is closely related to integrable systems. It wouldn't be surprising if you could generalize this
construction
somehow, right? So, definitely the equations of the isomonodromic deformations, they are very meaningful. So if you take their solutions, probably you'll have something meaningful.
Okay, so if there's no question from audience, let's thank the Todor for today's lecture. Okay. Does anyone have informal question or discussion to Todor? Otherwise, we will meet. We will meet tomorrow at the same time. Okay. Thank you very much.